So I don't know if you saw the rant that Jeff Stelling had last weekend, where he said that this was the first time that he'd heard anybody using expected goals. But expected goals are an important metric when you look at a football match, whether you're analysing it, whether you're trading it, whatever you're doing. Expected goals is a key metric that you should use in football. And that's what I'm going to talk about in this video. Please like and comment on the video below. That will allow me to produce better quality videos and more of them in the future. So Jeff Stelling was talking about expected goals recently, but in the wrong context. There was a match that had taken place and the manager had lost 3-1, and the manager turned around and said, well, you know what, Jeff? It was only 0.7 to 0.8 expected goals. So the match wasn't too bad. And Jeff Stelling went off on a major rant on that particular point. But the interesting thing about expected goals is it is a valid metric. So I've done videos on how which statistics I'm looking for within a football match, so definitely watch that video. But what is the key statistic that I use in a football match? But I also use it whenever I'm forecasting and within the match itself as well. So I thought it was worth doing a video explaining about the expected goal metric, or XG as they abbreviate it, and exactly what XG is and how that it works. But it's worth giving you the backstory as to how I got there, best part of 30 years ago, to understand what was important within a football match. So if you've seen videos before on this, you would have known that many years ago I ended up winning a first dividend on Littlewood's pools. And the way that I did that was to start predicting and trying to understand how a match would end in a draw. So I pretty quickly figured out that if the away team was likely to score first, and then a draw was more likely, and stuff like that. And that got me into the world of statistics and trying to understand exactly how to price a football match. So I picked up and ran with that from a very young age. And I figured out if I worked out the draw, I could work out other components of the match and so on and so forth, and all of those things. But that led me into a sort of a deeper level, because you forecast things, especially when you're trading. You sort of say, this match should be the way that it is, or this is what should likely happen and how, and therefore this is how I will trade it. But very often in football, it just doesn't happen. It's just strange things happen. So the guy, the ball comes over the defender, the guy runs through, he's one-on-one with the goalkeeper, and then somehow conspires to completely miss. And you're sort of thinking, how on earth did he miss that? Or, I remember it really well actually, in a Chelsea match once, Didier Drogba got the ball from about 40 yards out, just whacked the bloody thing, and it flew into the back of the net. And it was just like, ugh. And, that's the way that football tends to play out. So when I was trying to work on prediction models, I figured out that, you could have a match that ended up 3-1, but that wasn't really a very accurate reflection on the way that the match should have actually played out. So I started to begin focusing on chance creation and shots on target and stuff like that. So when you look at shots on target, that gives you a good... So, for example, just to shortcut it, and it's a really rough, brief, sort of rough and dirty way of looking at shots on target, but basically about three shots on target tend to lead to one goal. And probably about 9 or 10 shots overall, a third of those will be on target, and therefore a third of those will end up in the back of the net somehow. And that's really, don't hold me to those stats. I've got the actual stats on a spreadsheet somewhere and broken down in a number of different ways, but that's sort of a rough overview. So by predicting how many shots are likely to be and how many teams will take shots and so on and that, I was going to say so on and so forth, but somebody picked up on this in another video, so I stopped briefly there. But by looking at either team and their chance of shooting and having shots on target, that sort of leads you to predict roughly how many goals are likely to be scored within a match, and you can net those two off against each other. But I figured out that very often this is wrong, especially at the start of the season, because you could have 2 or 3 games in a row where the team has 4,000 shots and they just don't end up scoring for some bizarre reason, maybe because of an offside or a dodgy decision or something. Just things start to go wrong and don't stack up. So when I was doing my predictive modelling on football many, many years ago, I figured out that in fact, not all shots were created equally, and that in fact some shots were more likely to be goals than others. And that's essentially what XG is, what expected goals are. Because, but the way that I approached it was I didn't have data and there was no data available for me then. So what I figured out was that if you actually looked at a goal, then you could actually draw a line between the goalposts and where the shot was taken. And using a bit of geometry, you could figure out how much of the goal potentially was open for a good shot and a potential goal. Now obviously you have the goalkeeper in the way and stuff like that, but I started to map out where shots were taken in rough areas. I blocked out big chunks of the pitch and then said there's a shot in this area and it wasn't a goal, there's a shot in this area and it was, and there was a shot in this one and it wasn't, and it was and it wasn't, and in this one and so on. And just carried on doing that all the way down one half of the pitch, and then you start to get some numbers up. You build a heat map of where a goal is more likely to be scored. But then you begin to get into this deep world of, like, you know, if a goal is scored that way, then the ball needs to get there from somewhere. So if you then go back one step, then basically a cross to that position and then the chance for a potential shot, but then is the shot blocked? So I actually worked out that there were 19 variables that accounted for 95% of the difference between two teams, and started to work on each one of those individual metrics to pull together a model that would give me a really good piece of prediction. Now, of course, the thing is that, in fact, you know, loads of other people have been working on that, and I'd say in recent years that has totally exploded. So the market is pretty efficient in terms of most of the pricing most of the time, but not all of the time. As we see very often, there's a certain amount of variability in there, and there are changing factors within that as well. But essentially, when you look at a shot on target, each shot has a different chance of going in. So if you're 1 yard from the goal, then you can put it either side of the goalkeeper quite easily. But if you're 18 yards out, or 20, or 30, or 40, each shot from different positions, and using a bit of geometry, if you plot out, like, you know, the chance of taking a shot from the left-hand side of the area, or the right-hand side, or the middle, or somewhere inside between those two points, is obviously going to be different. And using that model allows you to make much, much better predictions, because you throw away the luck element. You say, well, this is the chance that a player has of scoring from this position. It's a 55% chance. And they had three shots from that position, and therefore, when you look at the team, when you break it down to its component parts, you get a very accurate prediction of how that team is playing and how they're likely to play in the next match. But XG now is something that is being produced and is appearing on media sites and so on and so forth, but basically it's a reflection of the true value of shots within that particular game. So this manager was quite correct in saying, well, you know, it should have been 1-1 really. We actually played fairly well, and therefore I'm not that worried. Now, the fact he lost 3-1 is a bit confusing, but essentially the way the team played, the strategy, the two of them interacting with each other, led to a situation that really should have been a result other than 3-1, but it just luck was against them. So XG is a good way of stripping out luck from all of your calculations and allowing you to predict forward more accurately than just using shots on target or any other sort of metrics. Now, as I mentioned, there are 19 variables I discovered that account for 95% of the difference between two teams. Really complicated model, that is. So it's not just down to that. There are other factors in play as well. But when you look at a match, and you look at a lot of the modern stats that are coming out of matches, XG is a great way of working out what's really going on within a match. Now, when you watch a match, you'll get a feel for whether one team is dominant or not. But by looking at stats like XG, which are available all over the place now, you can find them. It's amazing, because when I started doing this, I worked out the geometry of shots taking and tried to predict where it was, and then started to put stats into it to figure out if I was roughly correct. And that took me ages and massive amounts of data crunching to be able to come up with anything reasonable. And now it's right in front of you, available at all different number of sites, where you can get this real time, updated as the match is going underway. It's absolutely amazing. And, you know, from a trading perspective, most of these things are put up there for an information perspective, or for fantasy football leagues and stuff like that. But the fact is, for trading, they're absolutely awesome tools to be able to understand exactly what is going on with the match, or, you know, in a match that's going to be played in a week's time, how all of that will interact with each other. But also, you know, what impact an individual player will have on a team as well, because if their ability of converting shots is very high and they get removed from the team, then that XG rating, the number of shots that are likely to be taken and the chance of them being converted into goals, is going to drop off. And that will affect the overall structure of the correct score market, and match odds, and all the other factors, over and unders, within the match. And you can actually take account of that by removing that player from the team and looking at it from that perspective. So yeah, absolutely fascinating area to discover. If you've never looked at it before, please do so. But yeah, XG is, unfortunately for Jeff, is a real statistic. It's something that's useful and something that you should look at.